Do you struggle with bitterness, complaint, and feeling of resentful anger? Or hostility in reaction to a real or even imaginative grievance or betrayal? The feeling of being deprived or cheated? Friends, there is hope. God is still in control. You might be thinking why God is not answering your prayers. I'm doing anything wrong. I try to do everything right. Sometimes God changes you before He changes your situations. Let's learn our lessons from the book of Job, chapter 23, verses 1 to 9 and 16 to 17. Bitter complaints. Let's pray and start our service today. God, very often we pray for you to change our situations. Give us the job we need. Help us to sell the house. Heal us from sickness. Bless our children and our church and its ministry. Yet we know more importantly, you change us. Align our hearts with you today and nourish us the spiritual soul. Help us to take our next step towards a rich, vibrant prayer life. Teach us, O God, we commit this service into your hand. Bless us and help us. Help us to experience your loving presence. In Jesus' precious name, we offer this prayer. Amen. Please enjoy this service.
Everyone, happy Sunday! Have your parents ever showed you pictures of you when you were younger, maybe throwing a fit or a tantrum because things weren't going your way? Well, I found some memes on Pinterest of some kids who were having kind of a rough day and threw a fit about it. For example, this poor child did not want to wear his life jacket, so he was upset, even though his mom and dad were just trying to keep him safe in the water. This poor little guy had started eating part of the football, but his mom or dad took it away and told him he couldn't eat the rest of that football. Well, of course not. That's not good for us, right? This poor little guy, he just wanted to play with the outlets. But we all know it's not safe to play with outlets, right? You can get electrocuted. So his mom or dad had to tell him no and put the safety covers on the outlets. This poor little guy, he just wanted to eat his shoe. But his mom and dad told him he can't eat his shoe. So he was pretty upset about that. But we don't eat shoes, do we? No, that's pretty gross. And this poor little guy, he just wanted a new Mario game. But mom and dad said no. Maybe because he already has too many games? Or maybe they're saving up to buy it another time. For whatever reason, they said no, and he was not happy about that. And finally, this poor little guy, he just wanted to play with the water table. But it was 31 degrees outside and way too cold to play with water. Well, I think we can all admit that when we were kids, or you when you were younger, or maybe even now, if things are going your way and you're getting what you want from mom and dad, you're thankful, you're happy. But if you get told no for something, or your mom and dad don't let you do something for reasons you don't quite understand, we maybe throw fits or pout or talk back to mom and dad, don't we? Well, this may be how we sometimes react to God as well. When things are going great and we're getting everything we want and his answers to our prayers are always yes, then we tell him how much we love him and we pray more and we're happy. But when things are not going that way, we can be very quick to turn our back on him. Well, Job teaches us another way. His words may not always have been happy and cheery, but he showed unstoppable faith despite some horrible, sad circumstances. Through the story of Job's life, we can learn that even though sometimes we don't understand God or understand why we're going through something we're going through, we can still thank him. Our lives may be difficult at times, but we can still praise God. Will you guys pray with me about that? Thank you so much. You can bow your heads and repeat after me as we pray. Dear God, we thank you for the book of Job that teaches us that even when our lives are difficult, we can still count our blessings, give thanks, and praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much, everybody, and have a wonderful week.
Carpenter cleared the temple. All the buyers and the sellers are no different fellas than I profess to be. And it causes me shame to know I'm not the person I should be. Put your hand in the water. Take a look at get me through. With your hand in the hand of the man who sails the water. With your hand in the hand of the man who calms the sea. Take a look at yourself and you will look at others differently. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Put your hand in the hand of the man who sailed the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who calmed the sea. Take a look at yourself and you will look at others differently. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee.
Job's life has been turned upside down, his faith tested. In 23:8-9, he's having difficulty finding God. If I go to the east, he is not there. If I go to the west, I do not find him. When he is at work in the north, I do not see him. When he turns to the south, I catch no glimpse of him. I think we all desire to see God. What we do to do this is kind of an individual thing. Here are some suggestions.
Carla asked me if I would look out my back window and see if there's anything I see from God. Through our 12 feet of windows, I see many forms of plant life, beautiful flowers, fruit trees, mighty oaks, and many other kinds of trees. I see many kinds of animal life, deer eating fallen pear apples and acorns, many kinds of colorful birds that are feeders, and several kinds of beautiful butterflies. I see the beautiful clouds. I give God all the glory for this creation before my eyes. I am so thankful that I have been blessed with all of this. Thank you.
It looks, no matter what direction you look, if you see nature, you'll see to the north, there's apple trees and things that God's hands in. And to the south, you have the timber and the other beautiful things in nature. To the west, you have a bean field, you know, with the crop of the year. And to the east is more of the scenes in nature of the woods. It's just God is everywhere, all the time.
Good morning. Pastor's been teaching us about the book of Job. It's an interesting book. It's kind of a book about the story of our lives. One minute you can have it all, and the next minute it could all be taken away. I've been raised in the church, and I was taught to pray to the Lord, have trust in the Lord, and have faith in the Lord. Like all of you, I've had ups and downs. During the up times, I've turned to the Lord and thanked him for my blessings. During the down times, I've turned to the Lord and asked him to help me get through it. I have a tremendous amount of faith, and I'm sure all of you do too, and I think all we have to do is look around us and see all the things that God has given us and have faith. Have a great week. Thank you.
Good morning. Last week, Pastor's sermon was from the book of Job. In this book, Job is viciously and swiftly attacked by Satan. Job was a godly man. He was blameless and upright. He worshiped and loved God every day. But these vicious attacks took a lot from him. They took everything from him. Took all of his animals, 7,000 sheep, oxen, and camel, all his servants, but most sadly, took all 10 of his children, 7 sons and 3 daughters. Can you imagine such a profound loss? Job cries out to the Lord. Wouldn't you? I would be crying out to the Lord. He doesn't understand. He has had a really incredible favorship and had favor with God, and now he feels utterly forsaken. He doesn't know where to turn. He confesses he lacks understanding and needs the help of divine revelation. In Job 23:8-9, Job says, "Look, I go forward, but he, God, is not there, and backward, but I cannot perceive him. He works on the left hand, and I cannot behold him, and he turns to the right hand, and I cannot see him." Job has insisted that he has looked absolutely everything in the midst of his crisis for God. He looked in every direction, he said. But a few decades ago, a Puritan, upon reading Job's response, says, "Job, you have gone forward, you've gone backwards, you've gone left, you've gone right. Why don't you just try looking up?" I kind of think that we have that same problem. We often are in the midst of a problem. We have stress or hardship, and in the midst of that, we look in all the wrong places. Our wrong places may be being involved with relationships that are not healthy for us, becoming involved with substance, alcohol, or drugs, or maybe wanting lots of material possessions and working way too many hours and neglecting our families. We look for power and position, and we look in all the wrong places. We look up, forward, back, left, and right. But like the Puritan said centuries ago, what we really need to do is try looking up. He tells us that we can rely confidently on God, that he will always be there. He will bring us strength. He will bring us understanding. He will bring us comfort. But most of all, we will never be alone. He's always with us. Remember, try looking up.
Please pray with me. Our Heavenly Father, we are very worn out by the cares of this life. Our heart is very heavy and stressed, and our body is feeling the efforts of it. All that seems to be weighing us down. Our heart has become bitter and ungrateful, complaining, and we have taken many blessings in our life for granted. Father, we repent of our complaining and grumbling spirit. We know that we do not deserve to be part of this world, enjoy the blessings and privileges, even deserve anything that you have lavished upon us and bless us with. You do not owe us a thing. Yet we are such a great generation. Even while receiving your mercy and grace each day, we complain. We complain about our situations. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrificial death on the cross, replacing us, replacing me. Please fill our hearts and help us to rejoice and be thankful. Help us to overcome the struggles of bitterness and a resentful heart. Help us to guard our hearts against anything that may cause it to grow hard and bitter. We stand in the gap for our community, our friends and family. We ask you to bless us, protect us, be with us, guide us. We pray for our food pantry, village board, fire station, law enforcement officers, government officials, our state, school, our library, every businesses in our community, every household. Please protect us and bless us, O God. Please continue to provide for all our needs. We pray for our church and its leaders. We pray for our nation. We pray for those who are recovering and those who are struggling with addiction and other mental health challenges. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice and for the life that we can find only in you. We pray this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, our Master, our friend who taught us to pray, our Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. If you have any prayer concerns, please let us know. Send us an email. We have a great team of friends who will intercede and pray on your behalf.
Today's scripture is taken from the book of Job, chapter 23, 1 through 9, and 16 and 17. Then Job replied, "Even today my complaint is rebellion. His hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come to his seat. I would present my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn the words which he would answer and perceive what he would say to me. Would he contend with me by his greatness of his power? No, surely he would pay attention to me. There the upright would reason with him, and I would be delivered forever from my judge. Behold, I go forward, but he's not there, and backward, but I cannot perceive him. When he acts on the left, I cannot behold him. He turns on the right, I cannot see him. It is God who has made my heart faint, and the Almighty who has dismayed me. But I am not silenced by the darkness, nor deep gloom which covers me." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Bitter complaints. Job chapter 23, verses 1 to 9 and 16 and 17. Once a donkey said to a tiger, "The grass is blue." The tiger replied, "No, the grass is green." The discussion or the conversation heated up, and the two decided to submit this issue to arbitration. And for this, they went before the lion, the king of the jungle. Already before reaching the forest clearing where the lion was sitting on his throne, the donkey began to shout, "His Highness, His Majesty, His Greatness, is it true that the grass is blue?" The lion replied, "True, the grass is blue." The donkey hurriedly and continued, "The tiger disagree with me and contradict and annoy me. Please punish him." The king then declared, "The tiger will be punished with 5 years of silence." The donkey jumped cheerfully and went on his way, content and repeating, "The grass is blue." The tiger accepted his punishment because it came from the king of the jungle, as the lion, "Your Majesty, why have you punished me? After all, the grass is green." The lion replied, In fact, the grass is green, the tiger asked, "So why are you punishing me?" The lion replied, "That has nothing to do with the question of whether the grass is blue or the grass is green. The punishment is because it is not possible for a brave and intelligent creatures like you to waste your time arguing with a donkey. And on top of that, you bother me with that same question. It's a waste of time to argue with a fool and a fanatic who does not care about truth or reality. All what they care about is pleasing them. Some people are blind by their ego, capacity to understand. hatred and resentment. When ignorance is screamed, intelligent is silent. Your peace and quiet are worth more and worth more your time. There are many struggle with bitterness, regret, sadness and complaining. Do you struggle with complaining? We all do it. For some of us, it is our own default. Some of us cannot even talk about the next five sentences without bringing our mother-in-law or father-in-law, neighbors or Walmart cashiers. We all need to stop whining and start to find something to do with our time. The moment we complain, it shows our own resistance to change. Take responsibility. Lack of our own acceptance of God's authority and God's leadership in our life. In the church, we often hear the word that this is not the way we used to do this. It is a distraction, and in the life of the Israelites in the wilderness, it worked as an obstacle in the way to getting into the promised land. So don't be part of a dying generation. It's part of a dying generation that we complained. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to Him and He will make your paths straight. Proverbs chapter 3 verse 5 and 6. When we compare with anger, bitterness is worse because it involves feeling helpless. Psychologists call it as a embitterment. It thrives on sympathy. Maybe you need to put your story on hold. Sometimes telling your story again and again in a negative way to everyone around you is often a form of keeping yourself stuck in victimhood. Job, in our reading today, speaks his prayers out loud and shares his brokenness, bitterness, and mostly his feeling that God is not listening any longer. Silence is what he's getting. Listen and silent are spelled with the same letters. Think about it. Prayers change more than things. It changes you. For some, prayer is only asking God to meet all our desire, while prayer in the true sense is much more than that. Sometimes prayer invites us to conform our own wills to the will of God. In prayer, we change while God never changes. It is God's will, not ours, be done. I will share with you a story or a historic event that happened in the first century BC, written by Mark Patterson. He wrote this book called The Circle Maker, The Solution to 10,000 Problems. In the first century BC, a devastating drought threatened to destroy a generation. A generation before Jesus, the last of the Jewish prophets, died 4 centuries before Malachi. Miracles were such a distant memory that they seemed like a false memory. Horny Megal, a eccentric sage, lived outside the walls of Jerusalem, who dared to pray anyway, even while God seemed silent. While people could no longer hear God, he believed that God could still hear them. The drought hit hard the land. Horny was their only hope. He was known for his ability to pray for rain. While a 6-foot staff in his hand, Horny made a circle, making a circle movement rhythmically and methodically. Staying in the circle, he prayed, "Lord of the universe, I swear before your great name that I will not move from the circle until you have shown mercy upon your children." It was not just the volume of his voice, but the authority of his tone. His prayer was resolute yet humble, confident yet meek, expectant yet unassuming. Then it happened as the prayer ascended into the heavens, then the raindrops descended from earth. Sprinkling turned into a torrent rainpour that eyewitnesses said no raindrop was smaller than an egg in size. Eventually, people fled to the Temple Mount to escape the flash floods. Honi stayed and prayed inside his protracted circle. Once more, he refined his bold request. Not for such rain have I prayed, but for the rain of your favor, blessings, and graciousness. The legend Honi, the circle maker, stand forever as a sacred symbol, as a testament to the power of a single prayer to change the course of history. Honi prayed, he received, he refined, and he refined again. I thank God, still looking for a circle maker. Bold prayers honor God, and God honors bold prayers. If your prayers are not impossible to you, then they are an insult to God. Because they don't require divine intervention. There is nothing God loves more than keeping his promises, answering prayers, performing miracles, and fulfilling dreams. The greatest moment in life are the miraculous movement when human impotence and divine omnipotence intersect. They intersect when we circle around the impossible in our lives and invite God to intervene. God is waiting, and you are only one prayer away from a dream fulfilling, a promise kept, or a miracle performed. Who you become is determined by how you pray. The transcript of your prayers become the script of your life. We have not because we ask not, or maybe we have not because we circle not. Your prayer has the potential to change the course of history, and it is time to start circling around your own impossibilities. What do you want to circle around and pray for today in your life? Even if it seems hard for anyone to do it, or it seems impossible, remember God loves dealing with impossibilities. For the last century, we have had a widespread progress in prosperity driven by education, technological innovation, and sustained economic growth. When it comes to prosperity, things could hardly be better. We have made a huge advancement in communication, transportation, and our standard of living. In the matter of material well-being, increased educational opportunities have made unmatched strides towards leveling the social and economic playing fields. We have enjoyed a degree of educational opportunities, abundance, and personal freedom only the previous generations could only dream of. Yet we complain about everything. I know they have come with a cost. The economic powers of the corporations has in turn become political powers. With the overexploitation of natural resources, socio-economical discontent is also rising. The United States of 1870s, 1880s, and 1890s also forced inequality, political polarization, social dislocation, and cultural narcissism were the challenges of those years, and we have overcome that once. And today, after 125 years in our history, moving toward greater, or we are moving towards the same challenges in our political, socio-cultural context. Once we have done it, can we do it again? Yet we continue to become a generation of complainers. Job says, even today my complaint is bitter. His hand is heavy in spite of my groaning. If only I know where to find him. If only I could go to his dwelling. But if I go to the east, he is not there. If I go to the west, I do not find him. When he is at work in the north, I do not see him. When he turns to south, and I catch no glimpse of him. And all about impossibilities, all about ground, you know, making complaints. Let me ask you, my friends, and I believe God is looking for people who are theo, semioticians, the one who has the ability to look and see, the one who practices paying attention to the whispers of God, or come in alliance with the will of the Master. Job chapter 19, verse 25, 26, 27 says, "But I know that my Redeemer lives, and in the end he will stand upon the earth. Even after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I will see him for myself. My eyes will behold him, and not as a stranger. How my heart yearns within him." It is not over yet, my friends. God is still in control. The final chapters are yet to be written. This is also very true when it comes to the ministry of this church, ministry in this location. It is not over yet. God is still in control. Step out of our own comfort zone and pray the bold prayers. Oh, even though God, you seems not answering, or you are not listening, even though it seems to me like that, but we know that you are an answer God who answers our prayers. You are the God who listens. Anyhow, I pray, and I pray this bold prayer. Do you struggle with bitterness, and do you struggle with complaint? Let me ask you, your Father, keep that feeling away. Come to God with boldness, and he will answer your prayers. And I'm sure God is waiting for people to circle around their concerns so that God can answer yours and our prayers. May God bless you with those words. Circle around. Let me also ask you, or challenge you, as you drive around in our community in Spring Bay and in Peoria area, let me ask you to circle around our community. And as you drive around, as you walk around, can I challenge you to pray also, so that we can circle around our community, and then so that God can hear our prayers and answer our prayers. Please pray with me. God, our Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of grace. We come with boldness. We come with assurance that you will answer our prayers. Even it seems like sometimes it's difficult, and there is no response coming from you, because we want some of our answers right now. Maybe your time for your answers for the prayers just may not be right now. Lord, we ask you to help us so that we may continue to believe that you are a God who answers our prayers. We circle around our church. We circle around our community. We circle around our family's house. We circle around our children. We ask your Father that you protect them and bless them. And we give all the glory and honor. In Jesus' precious name, we offer this prayer. Amen and amen. May God bless you with those words. receive this benediction. Dear friends and family, never ever underestimate the power of prayer. Define your dream, claim your promise, spell your miracle. We have not because we ask not. Or maybe we have not because we circle not. God has the power to remove the obstacles into a crazy miracle. It takes some crazy faith and some crazy prayers. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, fellowship and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you today and every day. Amen and amen. May God bless you. Have a wonderful week.